Santor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Death Comes to the School by Catherine Lloyd, narrated by Cat Gould. Chapter 1. Kurland Hall, England, December 1820. After 3 years of marriage, Lucy, Lady Kurland, was used to Sir Robert's rather ill-tempered demeanour at the breakfast table. He hated to chat, which often frustrated her, because there was usually much to discuss about the upcoming day. Unfortunately, her husband had a tendency to hide behind his newspaper and offer only the occasional grunt to any conversational effort she attempted. Such was the case on this particular winter's morning, but for once, Lucy had little interest in engaging him in conversation. Despite having slept heavily, she was tired and somewhat cantankerous herself. The Yuletide season was fast approaching, and although her duties no longer involved managing the rectory and her father, there was still much to be done.
"The post, my lady."
"Thank you, Foley." Lucy accepted the silver tray the butler offered her and sorted through the collection of letters and bills, separating her correspondence from her husband's. "There's a letter for you from your Aunt Rose, Robert. She appears to be in London." A hand appeared around the side of the newspaper, and Lucy placed the thick letter in it.
"Thank you."
Lucy tapped her fingers against the stack of letters. She didn't want to open any of them. They would be full of sympathy for her health and well-being, and she really didn't want to think about it anymore. Not because she was unappreciative of the concern, but because she didn't need to feel any more miserable than she already did. She sighed, her gaze shifting outside, to the dark clouds and barren landscape of Kurland Hall Home Park. The trees were stripped bare of leaves. A slight frost made the spiked grass glint in the occasional strip of sunlight that managed to filter through the greyness. There was also a wind blowing, which made her reconsider her plan of walking into the village. She had promised to visit her father at the rectory and was expecting several of the village ladies to call on her at the hall in the afternoon for tea. There were plans to be made for the festive season that would require the assistance of everyone in the vicinity. Lucy bit her lip. She had no stomach for marshalling the forces of the local gentry, who sometimes required delicate handling in matters of precedence. She held the highest social rank in their small community, and many looked to her to set the tone. Usually, such battles energized her. But today... She placed her napkin on the table and picked up her letters, pushing her chair back.
"Damned incompetent government,"
Robert muttered to himself behind the wall of his newspaper. He still had ambitions to become a Member of Parliament, but had not yet found a viable seat. Still hovering beside Lucy, Foley cleared his throat.
"Are you quite certain you have finished, my lady? You've eaten only half a piece of toast."
"I'm not hungry." She offered him a brief smile as he pulled back her chair. "Can you make sure the fire in my sitting room is alight? And can you ask Mr. Coleman to bring the gig around in half an hour?"
"Certainly, my lady."
Foley bowed low.
"And maybe a fresh pot of tea? I know cook has just baked some scones, which would be just the thing with some strawberry jam and cream."
"The tea would be lovely." She left the breakfast parlour and headed toward her sitting room, where, despite her concerns, the new maid had already lit the fire, warming the frigid space. Sitting at her desk, she sorted the stack of letters, putting the one from her brother, Anthony, who was currently stationed overseas, aside to read later. He at least would have no idea what had befallen her, and was refreshingly concerned only about his prospects of a glittering career in the Prince of Wales' 10th Hussars, and how to achieve them on a somewhat limited budget. She broke the seal on a bill from her dressmaker in Hartford and perused it. She had sufficient funds to pay the amount out of her quarterly pin money, which she managed meticulously to avoid having to ask Robert for additional funds. Not that he wasn't already a generous provider. Unlike a lot of the gentry, he had derived the bulk of his fortune from the industrialized North, and that inheritance had only multiplied during the years of conflict and the current political turmoil. She studied the last letter in the pile, It bore no postmark, and had no signature scrawled across the corner to frank it. The paper was cheap, and the handwriting uneven. Lucy frowned as she opened the single sheet and attempted to read the laboured script. You will die alone and childless. None of your heathenish spells will work. The Turners have cursed you forever. Lucy blinked and reread the single line. There was no signature. Who would send such a thing? And why? She fumbled for her handkerchief, afraid that someone would see her crying, and mortified at her own weakness. She'd come to consider the local healer, Grace Turner, a friend. Was it possible that behind her affable mask, Grace still blamed Lucy for what had happened in the past? Lucy forced herself to take a deep, steadying breath. This ridiculous urge to cry at anything must stop, Lucy told herself out loud. You are a very lucky woman who lives in a beautiful house with a man who... She paused. Who didn't even notice you'd left the breakfast table. But why should he? She'd done nothing but snap his head off every time he'd attempted to speak to her over the past few months. No wonder he'd retreated behind his newspaper.
Your tea, my lady.
She hastily straightened and hid the letter under the pile. Thank you, Foley.
And the gig will be ready for you at 11, if that is convenient.
That will be perfect. She kept her bright smile on her face until the butler had left, and consulted her daybook as to the tasks that awaited her. She would speak to Cook and Mrs. Cooper, the new housekeeper, then would trek upstairs to change into warmer outdoor garb. Sitting around moping was not her way, and there was plenty to do. Her twin brothers were due home from school at the end of the week, which was probably why her father was desperate to speak to her. Keeping them occupied and helping others would at least make her feel like a useful member of society.
Sir Robert?
What is it, Foley?
Major Sir Robert Kurland lowered his newspaper and stared at his elderly butler, who was regarding him with a distinct lack of approval.
Do you wish me to start clearing the table?
With a sigh, Robert folded his newspaper and looked around the breakfast room.
Where the devil is Lady Kurland?
She left the table about a quarter of an hour ago, sir.
Foley's accusing stare intensified.
She barely ate a thing.
What are you, her nurse? If she isn't hungry, she isn't hungry.
Even as Robert said the words, he was aware that he might have erred. The fact that he hadn't noticed what was going on around him was remarkably remiss of him.
Did Lady Kurland ask you to speak to me about anything in particular?
No, sir, but I thought she looked a little tired. We're all so worried about her below stairs.
I'm fairly certain the last thing my wife would want is to cause concern to anyone. She is simply intent on regaining her strength.
By not eating, sir?
Robert raised his head.
Foley, I have a great deal of respect for your opinion, but please do not suggest that I am unaware of the state of my wife's health.
I would never presume to stand between a man and his wife, sir.
Foley raised his chin.
But...
Robert heaved himself upright and grabbed his cane.
Where is her ladyship?
She was in her sitting room, but I believe she has gone upstairs to change, Sir Robert.
Thank you.
Robert made his slow way upstairs. His mended bones were always stiffer in the morning, and especially in the cold of winter. The more he walked, the easier it became, until he overexerted himself and had to start all over again. He could at least ride a horse now, even though fear lingered like sourness in the pit of his stomach every time he mounted up. This winter had been particularly hard on him, leaving his temper as uncertain as his gait. He tapped on the door of their shared bedchamber and went in to find his wife about to put on her bonnet in front of the mirror. She wore a dress in his favourite blue and had styled her hair in a braided coronet on the top of her head.
I thought Dr. Fletcher told you to rest.
He told me to rest if I felt tired. She didn't look directly at him, her attention fixed on tying the ribbons under her ear. I am perfectly well.
You look tired.
She turned then and allowed him to help her into her pelisse. I'm going down to the village to speak to my father. I shall return at noon. She picked up her gloves and her basket. Is there anything else you require of me? He scowled at her.
More than a moment of your time?
I spent half an hour with you at the breakfast table, and you barely noticed I was there.
Damn it, Lucy. I was reading, and I forgot the time, and...
And now I have to go out. I'm sure you wouldn't want me to keep the horse standing in this weather. Her smile didn't reach her eyes. Sophia is coming to visit Anna at the rectory to talk about the Christmas festivities.
She and Andrew have returned from London?
Yes, and will be celebrating the season with us. She hesitated. I believe I asked you about this in September?
And much has happened since then to make me forget,
Robert countered.
I look forward to seeing them both.
As do I. Lucy smoothed down her skirts. I must go.
Are you sure you don't wish me to accompany you?
Robert tried again.
I have a book to return to your father.
I could take it back for you.
Or I could meet you at the rectory after I've spoken to Dermot.
She nodded as she pulled on her gloves. I'm sure my father would be delighted to see you. He bowed and stood back, then opened the door to allow her to sail past him. As soon as she had disappeared down the stairs, he raised his eyes heavenward.
You're a bumbling fool, Robert Kurland.
Why had he hidden behind his newspaper? He knew she was unhappy, and yet he couldn't seem to put his concern into words or break through her reserve. Or mayhap it was because she wouldn't even accept that he was worried about her. It was like attempting to pet a tightly rolled up hedgehog in the palms of his bare hands. He would talk to his friend Dr. Fletcher again, and would see if he had any suggestions, although Lucy dutifully took every pill and potion the doctor offered her. But she looked tired and drawn and sad. Her indomitable courage and boundless optimism had seen him through some of the worst moments of his life. The least he could do was attempt to help her through her own crisis. But how? As he turned to leave, he thrust his hand into his pocket, and his fingers brushed against the letter from his aunt. He took it out and studied the neat handwriting. Lucy was very fond of his Aunt Rose. Perhaps there was something he could do after all. Lucy sipped her tea and nodded as Anna detailed her plans for the Christmas services. Her sister was in remarkably fine spirits, considering she had to deal with their father on a daily basis. But Anna had always been the rector's favourite child, and despite dropping the odd hint about her inability to find a suitable husband despite the expense of her London season, he seemed remarkably content to be managed by her. The notion of her beautiful sister sacrificing her chance of a husband and family simply to keep house for their father bothered Lucy immensely. If it wasn't for the fact that Nicholas Jenkins was a regular and faithful visitor to the rectory, and still unmarried, she might have attempted to persuade Anna to let her chaperone her into local society, such as it was, and mayhap even take her back to London for another season.
What do you think, Lucy?
Anna was looking at her expectantly, and Lucy scrambled to collect her thoughts.
I do apologize. I was wool gathering.
Her sister reached out to pat her hand.
Your head is in the clouds today. It is so not like you. Are you sure you are feeling quite the thing?
I am perfectly fine. Lucy attempted to quell her sister's concern. What do I think about what?
The notion of having the children who attend the village school sing at the evening church service the week leading up to Christmas.
I think that is a wonderful idea. Have you spoken to Miss Broomfield about the matter? Anna grimaced.
I was hoping you might do it for me, Lucy. As you and Sir Robert founded the school, she might be more willing to speak to you. She is somewhat intimidating.
I'm more than happy to ask. I haven't met her yet, and was planning on seeking her out. I'll call on my way back to Kurland Hall. How is your new kitchen maid settling in?
She is very eager to please, and gets on well with cook and all the other staff. I couldn't ask for anyone better.
I'm glad to hear it. She's Mr. Coleman's oldest granddaughter.
I know. She was busy chatting to him in the kitchen when I was just out there. It is nice to finally have a well-settled staff.
A bell sounded in the distance, and Anna rose to her feet.
That might be Sophia arriving. I'll order more tea.
It might also be my husband, Lucy called after her. He thought he would visit Father to return a book he borrowed. Then I'll make sure we have plenty of hot water. Or perhaps the gentleman will forego tea for something stronger. Despite Lucy's earlier fears, the rectory appeared to be running smoothly under Anna's sunny command. Her father seemed happier too. He had a curate willing to devote long hours to the spiritual welfare of the parish, which allowed the rector to follow his passions for horseflesh, hunting, and the pursuits of a country gentleman.
Lucy!
Sophia Stanford came into the small parlour and rushed over to embrace Lucy. She wore a bonnet with tall pink feathers and a luxurious fur-trimmed pelisse in a dashing shade of green.
I was so disappointed that you didn't come to visit us in London in September, Sophia scolded as she drew her arm through Lucy's and settled them both on the sofa.
We were all looking forward to it, and then I received Sir Robert's note that you were not well enough to travel. I reminded the children that we would be spending the Christmas season here in Kurland, St. Mary, which helped alleviate some of their disappointment.
Did Mr. Stanford accompany you today? Lucy asked.
No, he's at my old home, interviewing my mother's land agent and keeping an eye on the children.
Sophia smiled.
He really does take remarkably good care of me and our family.
Anna returned with a tea tray and had barely set it down before there was another arrival.
Mrs. Fletcher and Miss Chingford,
the new maid announced, just as Penelope and her sister came in the door behind her.
There's no need to be so formal, Fiona. We are practically part of the family,
Penelope said as she curtsied. She took off her bonnet, revealing her blonde ringlets and perfect complexion.
Good morning, Mrs. Stanford, Anna and Lucy. We saw the Stanford carriage and decided to step in and pay our respects.
Anna raised her eyebrows at Lucy behind Penelope's back and then moved forward.
Please join us for some tea. It is always delightful to welcome you both here.
Lucy had always thought it was a pity that Anna had not been born a man. She would have made an excellent diplomat. Within moments, Dorothea Chingford excused herself to search out the curate on a matter of spiritual guidance, leaving Anna and Lucy to deal with her older and far more outspoken sister. Penelope took off her gloves and settled into a seat. Despite her limited budget as the village doctor's wife, she always looked like she had just stepped out of a fashion plate.
It seems my sister has set her cap at Mr. Culpepper, the curate. What do we know about his family? Are they wealthy?
I believe his father is a vicar in the west of England and has several other children, Lucy offered.
Then probably not wealthy at all.
Penelope wrinkled her nose.
What a shame.
You realized that marrying for love rather than wealth was an excellent idea, Penelope. Why should your sister not follow your example? Lucy asked.
Because she isn't as foolish as I am.
Are you not happy in your marriage? Lucy raised her eyebrows.
I am very content with my choice, although if my dear Dr. Fletcher suddenly inherited a fortune, I certainly wouldn't regret it or turn it down.
Penelope turned to Anna.
Has Mr. Culpepper said anything to you or your father to indicate his intentions toward Dorothea?
He hasn't said anything to me, Anna said cautiously.
Would you like me to ask Father to speak to him?
I'll speak to him myself.
Penelope folded her hands in her lap.
I cannot have my sister wasting her youth on a man who has no interest in her. As you both know, I wasted far too many years waiting for Major Sir Robert Kurland to marry me.
After another wry glance at Lucy, Anna handed Penelope a cup of tea.
I believe you made the right choice in the end. It is quite obvious that Dr. Fletcher adores you.
Penelope batted her golden curls.
As he should, seeing as I condescended to forego the rank and privilege my beauty deserved to marry a non-entity.
Sophia choked on her tea, and Lucy patted her on the back. Within seconds, Penelope was interrogating Sophia about current London fashions, leaving Lucy free to sit in comparative peace. Dorothea Chingford would make an excellent bride for the curate. They had known each other for 3 years, and always sought each other out at social and church events. Dorothea did not have her sister's ambition and would welcome the opportunity to stay in the village she had grown to love. In the village, there was a small house owned by the church that would suit the young couple to perfection. Lucy made a mental note to remind her father to offer it to George Culpepper if the wedding took place.
Lucy, Are you still expecting us at Kurland Hall this afternoon to discuss the arrangements for the Christmas festivities? Penelope inquired.
Yes, indeed. Lucy placed her cup on the side table. In truth, I should not stay much longer. I have to go and speak to Miss Broomfield at the school.
Sophia pouted. You're leaving already? I have barely had a chance to speak to you.
I will gladly avail myself of your company at Kurland Hall this afternoon. In fact, why don't you and Andrew stay for dinner after that?
What an excellent idea.
Lucy looked up as Robert entered the room with her father. He bowed over Sophia's hand and then kissed it.
I was just coming to extend the same invitation. How are you, my dear Mrs. Stanford?
I'm very well. Sophia smiled up at him. Your best friend makes an excellent husband.
I'm glad to hear that.
As Robert spoke to Sophia, a bud of resentment unfurled in Lucy's bosom. Her husband was being remarkably charming for a man who'd barely bothered to manage three sentences to her over the breakfast table.
May I bring the children with me today? Sophia asked. They are looking forward to seeing you both immensely.
Robert cast a wary glance at Lucy.
I'm not sure. Lucy has not been well. She might...
Lucy cut across him.
I would be delighted to see your children, Sophia. How could you think otherwise, sir?
Sophia looked uncertainly from her to Robert, and then back again.
I'm glad to hear that, seeing as I am about to add to the brood.
She patted her stomach. Not until next Easter, I believe.
A chorus of congratulations rained down on Sophia's head, while Lucy smiled and smiled. Just to make matters worse, Penelope sighed extravagantly and came to stand beside Sophia.
I was going to wait until after the festivities to reveal my news, but I must confess that I am in an interesting condition as well, Penelope revealed.
Lucy stumbled through another set of congratulations, and then, while she was unobserved, she left the room and climbed the stairs to what used to be her bedchamber. She fumbled for her handkerchief and couldn't find it as tears dripped down to mark the patterned muslin of her bodice. When the door opened behind her, she delved inside the top drawer of her dressing table and pretended to be searching for something.
Is that you, Anna? I was just looking for a clean handkerchief.
Lucy.
She stiffened as a warm hand slid around her neck and she was turned into the comfort of her husband's arms. A large handkerchief was pressed into her palm.
It's all right.
For a long moment, she did nothing but breathe in his familiar scent and simply allow herself to be held. Eventually, she used the handkerchief to blow her nose and eased out of his arms.
Pray excuse me. It's not that I'm not delighted for both Sophia and Penelope. It's just that it should have been me announcing my news and...
I'm fairly certain that neither of them noticed you were upset.
He was watching her carefully, his attention fixed on her face.
Have you told Mrs. Stanford what happened?
It wasn't something I was comfortable revealing in a letter. I intended to tell her when she arrived.
Lucy dabbed at her eyes.
But how can I do that now, when she is so happy?
A small frown appeared on his forehead.
Surely she would still want to know.
That I am incapable of carrying a child?
Lucy, that's not what Dr. Fletcher said.
His unaccustomed gentleness made her chest hurt.
I do not want to put foolish fears into Sophia's head about her own current condition.
If she is truly your friend, she will notice you are out of sorts and will ask for an explanation. Do you plan on lying to her?
I hadn't thought about it. She raised her chin. What do you suggest?
It is hardly my decision to make, my dear. I'll tell Andrew the truth. I would rather not lie to my oldest friend.
Then may I suggest you don't?
He stepped away from her.
I do not want to argue with you about this.
I wasn't aware that we were arguing.
But we soon will be. Because every time I attempt to discuss what happened, you turn it into a battleground.
Tears started in her eyes again, but she ruthlessly held them back.
Are you suggesting that everything is my fault?
No, I'm attempting to.
Because you would be correct. Everything is my fault. Now, would you kindly remove yourself from my presence so that I can compose myself?
He visibly set his jaw.
I am your husband. Surely I am entitled to express my feelings for you and discuss what has occurred.
As far as I am concerned, you have already done everything required of you, sir.
So I am supposed to ignore the fact that you are tired and miserable?
Yes, she stamped her foot. I would feel much better if everyone would stop remarking upon it and let me be.
Everyone?
He took a step back.
I see.
She gathered the last of her pitifully stretched resources.
Can we not discuss this at home? I do not want my father to hear us arguing.
We are not arguing.
He shoved a hand through his hair.
You are merely angling for a fight, and I am refusing to indulge you.
Then if you will not leave, can you continue to indulge me and allow me to continue on my way?
He studied her for a long moment before moving to one side. He flung open the door and bowed low.
My lady.
She went past him and practically ran down the stairs and out the front door, forgetting her bonnet in her haste to leave. She didn't want him to be kind and understanding. She wanted him to... What did she want?
Mr. Coleman emerged from the kitchens and handed her into the gig.
Major Kurland said you were ready to leave and to give you this.
He placed her bonnet on the seat beside her.
Now, let's get you home.
I need to visit the schoolhouse first.
Then I'll take you there, but no loitering around in the cold now, my lady.
Chapter 2 Kurland St. Mary School occupied a building, owned by the Kurland estate, on the edge of the village, close to the duck pond and open fields. It had once housed one of the village smithies, and had fallen into disrepair when the family left to live in Hartford. It was built of sturdy brick and stone. The gutted interior had been restructured to allow for one large classroom and a cloakroom where the students could hang their outdoor things. At the rear of the property was a separate door into the teachers' living accommodation, which continued above the schoolroom. As the Kurland family had endowed the school, Lucy had spent many months poring over the designs and interviewing prospective teachers. Miss Broomfield, the current teacher, had only recently taken up the position after the previous teacher, a woman Lucy had liked tremendously, had left to marry one of the local farmers. Miss Broomfield had come highly recommended by an acquaintance of her father's. Lucy hadn't formed an opinion of her yet. Because of the nature of a rural village, most of the children who did attend came after they had fulfilled their obligations to their families. Some of them worked on the local farms, others in the villages or alongside their parents at home. Robert had insisted that all the children who lived on the Kurland estate should have the opportunity to attend school, but there were many parents who resented the time their children spent away from home and considered the idea of education wasteful. Lucy had insisted that girls be offered the chance to attend as well, which had scandalized everyone in the county, except perhaps her father and her husband. In truth, very few of the girls attended, but two of the older ones had been employed to assist the teacher and were paid well enough to stop their families from grumbling. Lucy climbed the steps and pushed open the door that led into the cloakroom of the school. The smell of damp clothes and unwashed bodies engulfed her, and she tried not to breathe too deeply. The door to the schoolroom proper was ajar. Lucy could hear voices chanting a multiplication table. There were often more children at school during the winter months, when there was less for them to do on the land. The design of the school included a large fireplace, which kept the building warm, even during the coldest of days. She suspected some of the children came to school simply to be warm for a few hours, and she could hardly blame them.
John Thacker!
Lucy flinched as the teacher's cane smacked on wood.
Yes, miss.
Are you sleeping again?
No, miss.
As Lucy opened the door, the sight of the schoolmistress greeted her, cane raised, ready to strike the small boy cowering in front of her.
Good morning, Miss Broomfield,
Lucy called. The teacher froze in place, the tip of her cane quivering an inch from the boy's ear.
Who are you, and what are you doing in my schoolhouse?
Lucy raised her eyebrows.
I'm Lady Kurland.
Lady Kurland?
Miss Broomfield lowered the cane and placed it on her desk.
I was not expecting you.
Obviously. Lucy gave the teacher her haughtiest smile.
May I speak with you for a moment?
If you insist.
Miss Broomfield pointed at an older girl sitting quietly at a desk on the side.
Rebecca, take over the lesson. I shall return momentarily.
Yes, Miss Broomfield.
Lucy patted John's head as she passed him and followed Miss Broomfield into the more private part of the school. The teacher held the door open for Lucy and closed it behind her before going to stand behind her desk, her black skirts rustling as she walked. She was shorter than Lucy, her features were sharp, and she held herself ramrod straight, like a soldier on parade.
I would prefer it if you would send a note asking if it would be convenient for me to speak to you before you arrive at my school, Lady Kurland.
In future, I will bear that in mind. Lucy declined the offer of a seat. I came to inquire as to whether the children would be available to sing at one of the Christmas services.
At Kurland St. Mary Church?
Yes. Have you continued Miss Brent's music lessons? Miss Broomfield's dark eyes narrowed even further.
I am not in the habit of wasting valuable hours in the schoolroom on such frivolous undertakings, my lady.
Then perhaps you might reconsider your position. Lucy's smile was pleasant enough, but she didn't intend to be talked down to. I'm certain it was made clear that we expect the children to receive a well-rounded education.
When most of them barely know their alphabet, Miss Broomfield snapped. And a private school too tired and lazy to apply themselves?
Most of them have already put in a hard day's work before they get here, Lucy reminded her. I agree that reading and writing must be a priority, but there is always time for music and art.
Hmm.
Miss Broomfield's determined expression didn't waver.
I'm not convinced that children should be allowed to perform in front of an audience. We do not want to put ideas into their heads.
Ideas about what? Lucy asked.
About other ungodly occupations, such as a career on the stage, or thinking they are somehow special because they have performed for their betters.
As they will be performing in front of their own parents and families, I hardly think it will turn their heads. Lucy reached behind her and rested one hand on the bookcase. Despite all her protestations to the contrary, she sometimes did feel terribly tired.
But still, Lady Kurland,
thank you for your time. Lucy gathered her resources. If you do not feel you can help with this matter, I will inform Sir Robert and my father of your decision. Miss Broomfield frowned.
I didn't say I wouldn't help out, Lady Kurland. I merely suggested that it doesn't sit well with my conscience. I am, however, well aware that my position here rests on my ability to appease the whims of my employers.
Indeed it does. Lucy inclined her head an inch. How could her father and Robert have offered this dreadful woman the position? If Lucy had been well enough to interview her, she doubted Miss Broomfield would have won her approval. If you prefer it, I can come in and teach the children the carols myself.
Oh, no, that won't be necessary, my lady, Miss Broomfield said quickly. Just send me a note as to what they need to learn, and I will set one of the girls to the task.
Thank you, Lucy nodded. While I am here, is there anything else you need to discuss with me, Miss Broomfield?
Well, the chimney in my part of the school appears to be partially blocked, Miss Broomfield said begrudgingly. I dare not set a fire in there.
I will send someone to deal with that directly.
Thank you.
Miss Broomfield's smile was less pinched this time.
Other than that, the accommodation you have provided is more than adequate.
I'm glad to hear it. Lucy turned toward the door. Is John Thacker really falling asleep every day?
Indeed he is. I cannot understand why he even bothers to attend if he can't keep his eyes open.
Miss Broomfield walked around her desk to join Lucy. She smelled of damp wool and strong lye soap.
His sister is almost as bad.
It is probably because his mother has just had another baby. The teacher sniffed.
And how many children does that make? 10 now, is it?
Surely the good Lord tells us to accept what is given to us and rejoice in it, Lucy countered, and mentally made a note to send poor Mrs. Thacker some extra provisions from the Kurland Hall kitchen. The family lived on one of the outlying farms, and the house must be full to bursting.
Well, as to that, there is such a thing as abstinence, my lady.
Indeed.
But who are we to judge what is right in another couple's marriage? Lucy said sweetly.
As I have never been married, or wished to indulge in such a union, I can hardly comment, Lady Kurland.
Exactly. Lucy returned to the schoolroom, Miss Broomfield behind her. John Thacker was already asleep, his head cradled in his arms on the desktop. He wasn't the only child who had taken advantage of the teacher's absence to take a nap. Lucy cleared her throat quite loudly, and several heads shot up. She nodded at Josephine Blake, who was helping one of the little ones read from the Bible. Thank you for taking such good care of the children while I talked to Miss Broomfield, Rebecca and Josephine.
You're most welcome, m'lady.
Rebecca Hall cast an apprehensive glance at the teachers.
I did my best, but...
That's enough, Rebecca. You can resume marking the spelling tests.
Miss Broomfield reclaimed her cane and took up her position in front of the suddenly attentive and silent children.
We shall continue with our recitation. Good day, Lady Kurland.
Having been summarily dismissed, Lucy returned to the carriage and allowed Mr. Coleman to hand her into the seat. She would have to talk to Robert about Miss Broomfield. She didn't believe the woman had the right characteristics to be in charge of young, impressionable minds. Her obvious sneering at those less well-educated or fortunate than herself had not won Lucy's approval. As her husband held far more outlandish notions about educating the masses than Lucy did, she assumed he might want to reconsider his decision. Lucy sank back against the cushions of the carriage and contemplated the leaden skies. There was definitely a hint of frost in the air and a breath of winter rolling in across the barren fields. She acknowledged the curtsies and pulled forelocks of the villagers as she drove down the main street, but didn't stop to talk to anyone, which was unlike her. In truth, she was exhausted, and if she wished to be a competent hostess to her afternoon guests, she would need to resort to a restorative nap. Both Grace Turner and Dr. Fletcher had insisted that she needed to eat more, but her appetite had deserted her. She shivered as the carriage turned out of the village street and onto the road that led to the gates of Kurland Hall. Perhaps it was time to abandon the gig and ask Mr. Coleman to bring out the older, more comfortable, closed carriage.
"Almost home, lady,"
Coleman called out as they turned into the elm-lined drive up to the hall.
"Thank you."
She caught glimpses of the back of the hall, which still displayed its timber-framed Elizabethan origins, through the bare trees before the carriage came around to the front entrance, which had been modified and modernized by Robert's father. Due to 500 years of familial meddling, the interior of the hall was somewhat confusing. Occasionally, guests ended up in the wrong wing of the house, or had to be rescued by the staff. Robert loved his family home and refused to admit it could be improved upon, despite the fact that her father had knocked down the medieval rectory and had rebuilt it in modern, Adam-style square stone. Lucy secretly preferred the hall. If Robert did not have an heir, 500 years of continual occupation of the hall by the Kurland family would come to an end, and his cousin, Paul, a despicable rake who had been banished from the country, stood to inherit everything. Lucy shuddered at the thought as she stepped out of the carriage to find Foley already opening the front door. It was her duty to provide her husband with an heir, and so far she had failed him.
"Welcome back, my lady."
"Thank you."
Lucy removed her gloves as she stepped inside. "I'm going to speak to Mrs. Cooper, and then I'll be going up to my bedchamber. Ask Betty to attend me there."
"Yes, my lady."
Foley took her gloves.
"I shall find her immediately."
By 3 o'clock, Lucy was sitting in her drawing room, pouring tea for her guests, who included her sister, Anna, Penelope Fletcher, and Sophia. Foley appeared at the door and announced new arrivals with all the formality of a county ball.
"Mr. Nicholas Jenkins and Mrs. Jenkins, my lady."
Lucy rose to greet her elderly guest and led her toward the chair closest to the fire.
"Thank you so much for coming, Mrs. Jenkins. Would you care for some tea?"
"I'd prefer something stronger,"
Mrs. Jenkins winked at Lucy.
"Hot whiskey and ginger would certainly help my sore throat."
"I'll tell Foley to bring you a glass immediately."
Lucy spoke to Foley and then paused by Nicholas Jenkins, who had stopped to talk to Anna. Thank you for bringing your grandmother, Nicholas.
My pleasure, my lady. He bowed over her hand. I am always her willing servant.
Anna touched his sleeve. I will escort your grandmother home today and save you another trip. Nicholas smiled down at Lucy's sister. He was a tall young man with a pleasant face and dark brown eyes.
You are all that is considerate, Miss Anna. I will look forward to your arrival.
He winked at her.
And mayhap persuade you to stay a while and enjoy our company at dinner.
Anna smiled back. Thank you, Nicholas, but I have to be home this evening. My father is anxious to discuss the arrangements for the Christmas church services.
Another time, then.
Anna moved away to speak to Mrs. Jenkins, leaving Lucy the only one to see the frustration on Nicholas's face. Impulsively, Lucy lowered her voice. Don't give up on her quite yet, Mr. Jenkins.
I won't,
he sighed.
But I must confess that sometimes I wish your father to the devil.
I quite understand the sentiment, Lucy said.
She won't leave him,
Nicholas continued, his gaze fixed on Anna.
And I am at a loss of how to persuade her otherwise.
We will think of something. Lucy patted his sleeve. Do not despair. She accompanied him to the door and met Foley, who was returning with more guests.
Mrs. Greenwell, Miss Greenwell, and Miss Amanda Greenwell, my lady.
Foley puffed. Nicholas bowed to the new arrivals.
Good afternoon.
The older daughter, Margaret, held out her gloved hand and pouted.
Are you leaving? But I have just arrived.
Lucy glanced at Miss Greenwell, aware of her coquettish tone and fluttering eyelashes. Was it possible that Anna had competition for the village's most eligible bachelor?
Alas, I must depart.
Nicholas kissed Miss Greenwell's hand and stepped back.
I do apologize. I have some errands to run for my grandmother.
He nodded at Lucy and set off down the hallway. He had certainly matured during his years in London and was far more formidable than Lucy remembered. If there was a way to extricate Anna from the rectory, Lucy was certain he would find it.
What a shame Mr. Jenkins couldn't stay,
Mrs. Greenwell commented as Lucy led her into the drawing room.
He is such a pleasant gentleman, and so attentive to his grandmother.
Indeed. Lucy settled the ladies on the couch next to Sophia. His parents died when he was quite young, and Mrs. Jenkins brought him up when he wasn't at boarding school.
I know it was a delightful surprise to find such an eligible gentleman in such a rural location,
Mrs. Greenwell smiled at her daughters.
I believe Margaret finds herself to have much in common with him.
Lucy looked around the room to ascertain exactly where Anna was, and then leaned closer to Mrs. Greenwell. I have a suspicion that Mr. Jenkins has set his sights on my sister Anna.
She is quite beautiful,
Miss Greenwell agreed with a sigh.
But he has not made a formal application for her hand yet, has he?
I don't believe he has.
Mrs. Greenwell visibly brightened. Then perhaps, when he is given the opportunity to spend more time with my Margaret, he might change his mind.
Lucy couldn't blame her for her optimism. Marrying off one's daughters was a primary concern of any loving mother. She doubted the Greenwells had the resources to afford a London season for either of their daughters, so they had to be content with attending county balls and meeting young men at their neighbours' houses. While she might sympathise with their plight, she had no intention of allowing Margaret Greenwell to monopolise Nicholas Jenkins. Anna deserved to marry a man who not only had loved her for years, but was also the heir to a viscount.
Good afternoon, Lady Kurland.
Lucy turned to find one more guest slipping unobtrusively into the drawing room.
Josephine, how nice to see you. Did you accompany the Greenwells?
Yes, my lady,
she curtsied. The girl still wore the drab blue muslin dress and pinafore she had worn earlier at the school. Lucy wasn't quite certain of the relationship between the Greenwells and Josephine Blake, who acted as a part-time companion to their daughters, as well as carried out her duties at the school. It was Lucy who had persuaded Robert to offer the paid position to Josephine. She knew how hard it was to live on the charity of others, and hoped the money Josephine received gave her at least a small measure of independence.
Not that the Greenwells appeared to mistreat her. They just made it obvious that Josephine was not to be considered a young lady at home or as part of their immediate family. Rebecca Hall, the other girl who worked at the school, was from the large family who operated the remaining smithy in the village. She had marched up to Kurland Hall and had stated that she didn't want to go into service and wanted to keep learning. Impressed by her desire to improve herself, Robert had not hesitated in offering Rebecca employment as well. "Come and sit down, Josephine. You must be worn out after working at the school."
"Worn out?" Mrs. Greenwell looked up. "She only has to assist Miss Broomfield, Lady Kurland. It is hardly an onerous task."
Lucy smiled at her guest. "Just the mere thought of dealing with a dozen children makes me tired. I was at the schoolhouse this morning. I have nothing but admiration for anyone who undertakes such a task." Margaret shuddered.
"I would not step foot in there. Those children smell quite dreadful, and I suspect some of them have fleas."
Anna spoke up before Lucy could open her mouth.
"That's because they often do not have access to those things you take for granted, Miss Greenwell, such as hot water to wash in, spare clothes and boots, and sometimes enough to eat," she said. "Come and sit with me, Josephine, and I'll pour you some tea."
"Don't encourage her to sit, Miss Harrington."
Mrs. Greenwell's laugh was patently false.
"She'll fall asleep, and then where will we all be? I thought she could take notes about the meeting and be helpful. Otherwise, I wouldn't have brought her with us."
Josephine stepped back so fast she collided with Lucy.
"I'm quite happy to offer my services."
"I accept your offer with gratitude. But first, sit down and have some tea while I gather my thoughts," Lucy said. Lucy took hold of Josephine's elbow and steered her over to where Anna was sitting. Anna patted the spot on the couch next to her, and Josephine sat down, casting a wary glance over at Mrs. Greenwell, who was still smiling, if a little rigidly. Knowing that Josephine was in safe hands, Lucy turned her attention to the rest of her guests and made sure they were all supplied with sufficient tea, coffee, and the delightful little cakes cook had sent up from the kitchen. When everyone was settled, she cleared her throat. "Shall we begin our meeting?" Josephine went to sit at Lucy's desk and took up her pen expectantly. "Thank you all so much for joining me," Lucy smiled at her assembled guests. "Firstly, Sir Robert and I have decided to hold a ball on Christmas Eve." Mrs. Jenkins spoke up.
"How lovely, and how very kind of you both."
"I'm looking forward to it already,"
Margaret exclaimed to her sister. "We have also decided to hold a dance for our estate workers and the villagers, with games and presents for all the children."
"A very worthy cause," Anna clapped her hands. "How can we help?"
Lucy unrolled her list. "I have jotted down a few suggestions, and I would certainly value everyone's assistance. Perhaps we might start with the more practical arrangements and move on from there." An hour later, after all the women had spoken up and agreed to provide what Lucy asked of them, she folded up her list.
"Thank you."
Lucy straightened her shoulders. "Now, all that is required is for me to write out 150 invitations and have them delivered in time."
"I can help you with that,"
Anna and Sophia both said at once.
"And I will send Dorothea to aid you as well," Penelope added.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.